Welcome to Cross-Border Tax Talks, where we discuss the latest trends in international taxation, from U.S. tax reform 2.0 to the European Union's latest developments. I'm Doug McConey, PwC's U.S. International Tax Services Leader. You can watch these podcasts on YouTube at youtube.com/Doug McConey. On this week's episode of Cross-Border Tax Talks, we're recording live from the Westminster Studios in St. Louis, Missouri, where I'm excited to be joined in person again by Martin Mascant. Martin is a U.S. tax partner who is a member of our integrated global structuring team and leads our foreign tax desk based out of New York. Before joining the firm, Martin was a partner in our Dutch firm. Martin, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Doug. Great to be back and great to be in person.
So nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Getting back to normal. So, Martin, you're one of the New York City pandemic evacuees who recently moved to Dallas, Texas. So I thought we'd just start by telling me, what was that experience like and how is a Dutchman in Texas faring?
That's a great question. And it was a surreal experience. It was an adventure. Moving during a pandemic with limited travel, you want to take care of all the safety protocols. 2 weeks before we moved, we didn't exactly have a house to move to. So it was it was exciting, but also a bit like, this isn't normal. This isn't what we should be doing, perhaps this way. But everything worked out quite well. And to be honest, we love it.
It's great.
Dallas is a great city, great people. But I have to admit, I miss New York a bit.
Oh, yeah. It's a lot more space out there in the middle of the country, for sure. But my follow-up question, though, is, have you bought a pickup truck yet?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
I have been looking for cowboy hats, boots, but no truck.
Okay. I maybe start with the truck. I can't see you in a big 10-gallon hat or cowboy boots. But when that happens, let me know. I'll come down to Texas. So I'm excited to have you on today to get an update on all tax matters going on in the EU. And I'll be honest, Martin, I've never experienced the volume of change and information that is coming out from a tax perspective across the globe, right? As we think about all of the regulations still finalizing from the TCJA, most of that dust is settled. Now we have a new administration in the US and thinking about US tax reform 2.0. And we had Pat on for the last episode talking about the Green Book and those potential changes. And then there's been a lot of focus on the OECD and the G7 meetings and what we can expect later in the summer. But in the meantime, the EU has been very busy with a number of different policy changes and court cases related to state aid and some other things that are on the horizon. So I thought we would start with state aid. And to remind our listeners, there are still state aid cases going on, right? This has been what feels like been going on forever.
Yeah, you're right. State aid kept moving forward. There are a couple of big known cases. Abdul, state aid was always in play, but we have seen in the last couple of years with the big known cases, much more attention to state aid. And the cases were open through an investigation of the European Commission. In most cases there are still some cases pending during the investigation, and where we had a number of finalized investigations, and the Commission typically came to the conclusion there was unlawful state aid granted to those companies. Mm-hmm. The procedure then is that the companies can appeal that decision, or the countries involved, the jurisdictions involved, and you have to go to court. And I think with most of the known cases, we are somewhere in the court procedure.
Right. And so I think that the last big case we had was Apple. Until most recently, now we have Amazon and Angie. And both have some interesting kind of novel issues that were addressed. And, you know, one of the key things, and we've talked about this on prior podcasts where you've joined, is this concept of selectivity. But before we get into some of the substance, particularly with the Amazon case, remind me, you started to touch on this the procedure, like, and where we are, like the various, because we've got the European Court of Justice, which is the highest law of the land. So remind me, where is Amazon in the process?
So if you focus on Amazon, we just got a decision from the general court. It's the court in first instance. Conclusion was that the general court said there's not unlawful state aid based on the looking at the decision of the European Commission. At least we overturn that. What now can happen is that that decision can be appealed. Mm-hmm. Typically, there's just over 2 months for that, and then it will go to indeed the Supreme Court, the Court of Justice. But one thing we have to keep in mind is that the appeal can only be for errors in law. So it is a bit of a limited appeal, but once it's at the highest court and we have a verdict there, that's final.
Got it. So it can't be really an interpretation of the facts and how they apply. It's really how the law itself is interpreted, and that can be appealed.
Exactly.
All right. So why don't you remind us of the facts of the Amazon case?
So in short, Amazon had a Luxembourg operational company, an entity in Luxembourg, tax resident in Luxembourg, tax paying in Luxembourg. And that company was in charge of Amazon's European business.
A lot of operational substance.
A lot of people, decisions, a lot of things going on. But in order to operate that business, that company had a license to use the IP of Amazon, and that license was with what we call in Luxembourg SES, a partnership which was transparent for Luxembourg purposes, and because of that, not a taxpayer in Luxembourg. That SES participated in a cost share with Amazon, so the SES participated in a further development of that IP to be used in the Amazon business. Is that the Luxembourg authorities agreed with Amazon on the transfer pricing, on the remuneration, or I would say the profit to be paid, or the tax on the profit to be paid in Luxembourg by the Luxembourg operational entity, and the remainder of the profit would be paid as a royalty for that license to that Luxembourg SES, that reversed hybrid. The commission argued, saying, if you look at the residual profit split method that Luxembourg agreed to, whereby the Luxembourg operational entity was earmarked as the less complex entity, so that should be the tested party in the transfer pricing setup, and that's where we go and look for comparables and set the remuneration. The commission said, no, it should be the other way around. You picked the wrong method and you picked the wrong tested party. You should have used a different method, but even if you use this method, you should have tested the Lux SES, and without the people function in it, it should just earn a return, routine return mm-hmm. on the cost they have. Now, that was the base of the discussion and the court case. What the general court then said, and that was very interesting. First of all, the general court agreed with the commission, say, okay, we can test transfer pricing under the state aid rules, because mm-hmm. transfer pricing for big multinationals and agreeing to a certain remuneration may lead to giving an advantage to mm-hmm. that company, and giving it to one company is called a selective advantage,
right,
which then triggers the state aid rules or could lead to unlawful state aid. So the general court agreed with the commission on that point. So that's a point of law that they won, which is interesting because I said there's nothing to appeal for the commission right there. But then the general court continued and said, we have jurisdiction to test transfer pricing, but then commission, what you said is that a wrong methodology will lead to a conclusion that there is unlawful state aid. We don't agree to that, because picking a methodology, what's the advantage you give of that? No, you have to take a second step. You have to prove that the remuneration granted or the agreed profit level of the Luxembourg operational company is lower than the arm's length standard. And since the commission did not prove that, the general court said, there's no conclusion that unlawful state aid is given. And with that, the verdict is more or less in line with what we have seen in previous cases mm-hmm. with Starbucks, and also a bit comparable with Apple.
Right. And I think one of the pieces of news out of this is that transfer pricing is fair game for purposes of determining, particularly when some of these, you know, jurisdictions were giving rulings, that those rulings that were based on transfer pricing could be selective.
Exactly. And so, as you said, there are more cases and there are still some cases under investigation. And an interesting case for me coming up is, for instance, on IKEA, which is onshoring of IP, but it still is about what's the value and what's the value build up outside of mm-hmm. the country you're in. This may lead to a different approach by the commission when deciding upon these cases. But for now, every attempt to come to the conclusion unlawful state aid because it's the wrong method or the wrong tested party, the general court has overturned that. So that's pretty clear, you could say, up till now.
All right. So let's move from Amazon to Angie. I my French isn't very good. Is that how we pronounce this?
Yeah, but I think they we can just say Angie. Just say NG? It in the English way. They
just like
they
nice Midwestern Angie.
Yeah.
All right, I can handle that very easily. All right, so tell us about that. What was that case, and what was it? What was at issue with Angie?
Yeah,
Angie.
Angie was a structure where they more or less set up a structure within one jurisdiction within Luxembourg. Where through a three-step transaction, they created a deductible payment, more or less in hybrid financing within Luxembourg. They sold and they created so deductible expense whereby the income in the future would be received untaxed under the participation exemption. So what you had in a bit more detail, you had a Luxembourg company which sold a certain business to another Luxembourg entity, and that Luxembourg entity borrowed for that purchase under a convertible loan note mm-hmm. From Luxembourg to, let's say, the lender, and the lender entered into a forward agreement with the overall holding company saying, whatever I will receive, I will pay that to you. So what would happen in is that the Luxembourg entity received that which bulldozed that business would get income. It would then would be allowed the deduction for that accretion under that zero bond convertible note.
Sort of a deemed interest expense related to that.
Deemed interest expense. Yep. On the other hand, you had a deemed interest income, you could say, but that was offset by the deemed imputation, the deemed deduction on that forward sale agreement. And the holder of that forward sale agreement would in the future get that because it would receive shares under that agreement as income under the participation exemption. Now, complex structure, you could say, but the individual articles of the Luxembourg law were applied as Luxembourg thought they should be applied and how they are written.
Well-established principles, right, that they were applying, but it did create a deduction on one side, and then the other side was treated as dividend income that would otherwise have been a participation exemption. And so similar to the Amazon case, this is, and you described it as such, a what we would commonly refer to now under OECD rules as a hybrid instrument because of the arbitrage, which would, you know, under today's rules would be much more tenuous to put in a structure like that at this point. Exactly. So what was the legal issue? Because it was really a question about abuse of law, right?
Yeah, but let me address first one point. I want to make very clear that the participation exemption itself was ruled as, that's okay, that's not, allowing a participation exemption in a country is a well-established way to avoid double taxation. So that was out of the question. It was the general court, Morris, ruled on the abuse of law. And that's the interesting point indeed, Doug, mm-hmm. is we should not only look at the individual transactions, but also at the overall economic result of the various steps of that transaction, leading to a deduction, but not a taxable income. Mm-hmm. And then the commission, in their decision and the court ruled on that, said, we have to test that against the principles of the anti-abuse provisions, the anti-abuse principles laid down in Luxembourg law. And if we test that, then Luxembourg should not have agreed to giving a deduction if the income was not taxed, or the other way around. You should not allow a participation exemption if you have a deductible expense, because there's no double taxation to be prevented. And that's an interesting takeaway. It's the first time that the General Court ruled on an abuse of law. One important element here I want to make is, with this decision, the court did not create a European super GAAR or something like that. No, it was just testing the GAAR as laid down in Luxembourg law.
Right. So it had to look at actually those legal provisions that existed at the time. And then the point was, is that, well, if Luxembourg hadn't considered those appropriately, then presumably that would then be viewed as a selective advantage for that taxpayer, where the Luxembourg authorities failed to apply a provision of its own rule.
Exactly.
And so what is the status of that case, and what are sort of the consequences resulting from that holding?
Yeah, so the status is that both Amazon and NG were ruled mid-May. So we are still in the period where both the parties involved can appeal. I'm pretty sure NG will appeal this decision. It's the same that the commission may appeal Amazon.
And to your point, the NG position is really clearly a position of law, right?
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Whether this failure to apply this would create a selective advantage, as opposed to which transfer price, I'm oversimplifying, of course, which I tend to be pretty good at, which as opposed to whether the transfer pricing methodology, which is more a factual issue, whether Amazon had the right transfer pricing methodology.
Exactly. So where we are is it's still in court, and it may go to the Supreme Court, the Court of Justice, which will take another 2 years before we have the final answer.
What else is still out there? What do we have to look forward to? Obviously, we want to wait and see if Angie or Amazon or the commission is going to appeal to the court, the highest court, European Justice. But what else is going on with state aid?
So, if you look at state aid, a couple of cases. I think the first case is that's the Fiat case on financing in Luxembourg. The hearing for the Supreme Court just happened a month ago, so we will just have to wait and see for the first outcome. We have Gibraltar, we have the UK CFC rules. They're all still in process, and we have still a few cases where the commission is working on different concepts. But another element, and that's more or less related to state aid I wanted to address here, Doug, is a proposal for a regulation on foreign subsidies. And it's an interesting topic, because first time when I read it, I was like, and it has been going on with the white paper, it was like, are we now trying to apply state aid to non-European states which were not part of the European treaty? So
right.
How can you apply it? That. But I think if you look at the regulation, and let's one step back before I go into details. The regulation is still in process, still a proposal. It's not a directive, and European law directive is a piece of law that needs to be transposed in domestic law of jurisdictions. No, this is a regulation to be applied by the European instances, like the Commission. They can investigate, this give them power to investigate or handle certain cases and deal with it.
Let me pause you there, because that's an important distinction that I wasn't entirely clear on. So, like, as we think about the Anti-Tax Avoidance Directive, both 1 and 2, those are provisions that I think, first of all, the European Union had to unilaterally agree on these principles, right? And then each one of those territories, jurisdictions, then had to enact, you know, those provisions into their law. And we've seen like how long it's taken some of the jurisdictions, like Germany, for example, some of the inconsistencies across how some of the various jurisdictions interpret some of those rules. This one is different, what you're saying, because it kind of just, it can be applied by the commission itself and really applies to everybody in the EU.
Exactly. So whenever this is agreed upon, when there was voting by its competition law, so it's the normal procedure, it goes through parliament, it goes through the ECOFIN Council, and when it's agreed 6 months later, it's applicable. That's the time frame of what is mentioned in the regulation. So definitely different, and good to understand that. It's European law can be pretty complicated.
Indeed.
So what's the regulation about? There are three elements in it, and two are notifications that taxpayers, that companies must do if they run into these facts. And the two are, if for what they call a concentration, more or less a merger. Mm-hmm. And by doing that merger, and there's, let's say, a non-European party involved, it will get a subsidy or a certain incentive or from a foreign government, which enables them to make that or to do very competitive bid. Then, like normal competition law, if you do a big merger, you have to notify the competition authorities and they will investigate whether or not it's fair game. So the rules.
And when you say a merger, you're not necessarily talking about like a legal merger. This is an acquisition or just like two big companies or buying assets. Okay,
and
got it.
But the amount involved, it should at least be, one of the parties should at least have a revenue of 500 million. The foreign subsidy should at least be 50 million before you are in these rules for I would say, the concentration, as they call it in the regulation. Okay. Then you have to notify the commission and they will investigate, okay, is there any competition law that you know, is broken by, and is that unfair competition? And that may lead to rules like, okay, you should divest certain assets, or you should pay back part of the foreign subsidy that you received. So nothing, it's just an extra layer in the competition law.
So as an example, as we think about like China, for example, has some subsidies for high-tech companies. And so if a European company was buying a China company that had taken advantage of this types of subsidies, is that something that this could be in play?
Yeah, or think if... a Middle Eastern airline, and with all the grants and loans granted to the airline by their government, interest-free, for instance, and that made them possible to buy a European airline. That could be an example as well.
Fair enough. And you can imagine some of the stuff with like land resources and for oil and gas.
Exactly.
That where we see, where that's very commonplace.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's one. The second one is, and that's more about public bid, public procurement. If you are involved in that as a company and the bid has a value of at least 250 million, you also have to notify the commission of that and whether or not you received a foreign subsidy. Again, same kind of procedure we just talked about. The third one is a bit more interesting. It's more or less what they call an ex officio. So the commission can start it on its own initiative. And that says that, okay, we can do that for smaller mergers, smaller concentrations, but also where we think that a foreign company has been granted a foreign subsidy, and with that subsidy, it may distort competition in Europe. And perhaps it could be that Chinese company that gets a grant from the Chinese government and through which it can produce goods much cheaper, ships it to Europe, is it then distorting European competition? What has been made clear is that even fiscal, so tax incentives can be part of it. What's not clear yet is what should the link be? Is just giving you a manufacturing incentive? Is that, and you can produce goods, is that enough to have a clear link that you distort potentially the competition in Europe? Well, the goods fly over the entire world.
Right.
So that these things are not clear yet.
You could imagine like the foreign-derived intangible income in the U.S. Is that a subsidy? Is that some type of incentive that if somebody was buying, if the European company was merging or acquiring a U.S. multinational?
Yeah, those are question marks. Mm-hmm. And I don't, what we don't need to do is, okay, be totally worried and said, okay, everything is again, it's Europe, everything is doomed. No, that's definitely not the message. Although my nickname by a lot of my colleagues is, oh, there's Dr. Doom talking about Europe again. Is no, I'm not here.
There's been a lot of bad news in fairness to my colleagues.
Hey, I always learned from one of our old mentors, Rich McGinnis, is the best way to do business in Europe is by not doing business in Europe.
Unfortunately, it's a big market, obviously.
It's a big market, it's a great market.
So what are the consequences then if the commission finds that there was kind of this subsidy that was granted? Can they force a disposal or like what are the teeth to the rule?
So the measures they can take, first of all, they have to determine how much competition there is, because it's not only, you also have to take into account what good does it bring to Europe. Is it employment? Is it, other renting offices, creating jobs? you know, you have to take that to account, and it's that net amount which you distort competition. Or, and then they could ask either to dispose of assets, a business unit, they can ask you to repay that incentive, that grant that you got with interest. So those are the most important.
I see.
Yeah. But still the question is it, it also uses the terms like selectivity. Is it the same as the European state?
Yeah, there's very similar themes, right?
Themes, but it's not clear that they have the same meaning. So, my advice is be aware that's out there. Keep track of it. Be informed. Stay informed on these developments. The same with state aid. Stay informed. As says, every time you hear something, see something, does it have an impact on my business? Or whenever you do a merger, and then react to it, act to it.
Yeah, another important thing to add to the ever-growing list of things to be thinking about as part of diligence on any type of deal, it sounds like. And this was probably not on a lot of folks' radar. So a couple other things that want to kind of close out here with is first on public country-by-country reporting. And where does that stand in the EU? And I frankly have lost track. I can't remember even how long we've been talking about this, but I feel like everybody's comfortable with country by country reporting, and you know, and it's now just part of the compliance regime that taxpayers across the globe now had to deal with. And then, you know, obviously there are some concern from a number of taxpayers about the public information associated with that. I think less because of concerns about disclosure of where the profits are, and more that there are a lot of things that can be learned about a company's business, right? And wanting to prevent, you know, their competitors from understanding exactly how their business operates. So where are we on public CBCR in the EU?
Yeah, right. And it has been a file that has been around, I think, for 6 years now or so in Europe. And it was always more or less stalled between, you know, with the voting, are we moving ahead or not? But recently, there was a breakthrough. There was, you know, I think it's a tendency we see anyway around the world, increased transparency. So what are we seeing? That earlier this year, finally, the member states and with Parliament reached an agreement to move this file forward. We have now a draft directive, which has been recently approved by more or less the subcommittees, the Coreper and the URI committee of the Parliament. We can now expect voting by European Parliament and Council after a summer recess, and then it will be, if that's voted, it will be published, and then we have country by country in Europe.
So that's the individual state, the individual territories, jurisdictions do not need to enact that. This is another one of right?
Oh, sorry, to make it clear. So we then have a directive, and the directive needs to be transposed in domestic law within 18 months.
I see.
And then after the 18 months, it will be applicable, as I read the draft as available right now, for financial year starting on or after 1 year after that 18 months. So we're talking a long way out, but it's Europe. I just come here with a warning.
Right.
Some countries may decide to implement sooner.
Right.
And the moment you have one country in which you operate as a taxpayer, which requires you to do public country by country, you have to make that file.
Right.
So don't get excited if you say 18 months plus another year, and then the end of the financial year, you have 12 months to report. Oh, we're talking about 6 years out. No, it could very well be three years from now.
It only takes one country to adopt it and then to have to comply. And then once it's public, by definition, it's public. So it doesn't need to be out there for everywhere.
Okay. So in short, what are the rules? You need to publish on a country by country basis for your operations in Europe. And then if you're a company with 750 million in revenues, two consecutive years. So then you draw up a report showing per European jurisdiction, typical the country by country information, there's a list in the directive, and countries on the blacklist and countries on the gray list of Europe. They need to be separated as well with and showing that information on country by country. The rest of the world is just one aggregated amount with a short description of the activity. So it's really, I would say, European plus tax havens in the view of Europe that need to be reported on a country by country basis.
Got it. All right. So the other thing that we've been hearing about, and I'm not sure this is the legal name, is the communication regarding fair business taxation. So what is that? And there's so much procedure involved with each of these, and sort of where does this sit in the realm of EU taxation?
Yeah. So what is this? This is a communication on more or less the long-term and short-term, I would say, legislative agenda. of Europe. It has not the proposal itself. It more or less indicates five action items that they will take action on. Some will be short term, some will be long term. And yes, it also mentions, you know, the BEPS 2.0 initiative, the pillar one and pillar two, mm-hmm. but they will just mention whenever we get an agreement or we are waiting for that global agreement, we will implement, we will come up with a directive to implement those rules within Europe. And yes, there will be a lot of complications because in implementing those rules, we have to take account of European case law, especially for pillar two. But directives will come, and we know with directives, once adopted, it need to be transposed.
And the US Treasury does something similar. So it's really like a business plan and an intention of here's what's the kind of on the priority list for the EU.
Yeah. And a couple of more on the short term elements. And one of the, and I think Europe copied the US with coming with great names for some of the initiatives. One is DEBRA. And DEBRA stands for the Debt Equity BIAS. I forgot what the R was. Reduction allowance. Sorry, okay. That was it. So right. It's more or less the discussion, why do you get a deduction for interest on debt, but not for any yield on equity? So that favors financing by debt over equity. Sure. We should that take away. And one thing I want to mention is that last week we saw an impact assessment and with some questions, how are we going to do it? Or impact assessments, sort of consultation kind of stuff. And it mentioned three ways to do it. And that's where I started to have fun again, mm-hmm. as perhaps a European tax nerd, but it's always great to look to
read. That's why you're here, Martin.
Yeah. The first way to solve this issue is just deny every interest deduction, which, yeah, I was pretty surprised by mm-hmm. that, but we can then at least, it would save a lot of sub comments in pillar two anyway. And all the hybrid stuff can out of the and we can throw it away again.
The deductibility and the interest caps and
But right. Luckily, reading further, it became a bit more heartwarming, saying, okay, now perhaps we should, in addition to normal interest deduction, add a notional interest deduction on equity, like already a number of European countries has, like Belgium, Italy, Portugal, Cyprus, Malta, which are acceptable. They've been reviewed by the European Code of Conduct Group.
Right.
They're acceptable. And then a third option was, okay, allow notional interest deduction on equity, but also apply more or less the same percentage on your liabilities. Mm-hmm. So not the real interest you pay, but a notional deduction. Mm-hmm. Why is this important to pay attention? What I would like to say to taxpayers always is, be aware things are going on, and you can now submit comments on the website of the commission to this proposal, and be aware what's happening in Europe, but also make use of that momentum to submit comments.
Sure.
To be part of that, process. Yeah. And talk about with industry lobby groups or other industry groups that you're a member of to know what's happening and how you want to influence and be part of the process. Because say, hey, this could be beneficial or not, but the way it is regulated may be important. So pay attention to what's happening in Europe.
Well, that's why we're here on the cross-border tax talks, talking about EU. It's just amazing how much is going on, I mean, around the world. And, specifically EU, this is obviously something really to keep your eye on. Yeah. And I think, that's advice that we give regularly here on the podcast is to suggesting to taxpayers to take advantage of the process. And whether it's engaging within the U.S., with the members of Congress in a particular district, whether it's engaging with Treasury as part of a comment period on regulations and the EU now. I don't know how common this has been historically, but asking for comments and multinationals and taxpayers being able to participate in the process is really, really important.
Yeah, and also in Europe, perhaps it's more through industry groups and to have influence or submit now comments through online consultations. It's becoming more and more common, I would say, in Europe as well. And one other point I want to add on the business communication is BFIT. It's the other great abbreviation.
Okay.
BFIT stands for Business in Europe Fair Income Taxation.
Okay.
Meaning CCCTB is alive and kicking again. And CCCTB was the Common Consolidated Corporate Tax Base.
Right.
Meaning we will have one set of tax rules in Europe and we use formula apportionment to then
allocate, magically spread the profit around.
And even, you know, in the previous comments, in previous proposal, people were worried, hey, they don't take intangibles into account. This may not come back. For me, the interesting part will be, how will this fit in with the Pillar 1?
Right.
You know, if you're using a different apportionment than the Pillar 1, how does that work out? And again, it's something, and we will see a proposal come out somewhere in the next 2 years. But again, this is so important to be part of the process, because this will have a big impact on companies, especially if you're not perhaps subject to Pillar 1.
Right.
But if you will have kind of mini Pillar 1 within Europe, this will be the mechanism that Europe will use.
Fascinating. All right. Well, I think we're coming to a close here. Any closing comments or other things to be thinking about from a European perspective?
No, this is it. But find a way to stay on top. There's so much going on. Right. And I think it's so exciting for us, Doug, to be seeing what's happening in the US at Europe, at individual country level, European level, multinational level. It puts a big burden on any tax professional.
Right.
To
stay caught up on all this
stuff. Let's make this work together, and we can have lots of fun the coming years.
Yeah, and when we get new developments, you'll hear about it here on the Cross Border Tax Talks. And as we find out, get some of those additional state aid cases, we'll also talk about those. So yeah. Thanks a lot for coming in, Martin.
Yes, and I'll make sure I will earn that T-shirt for coming in multiple times.
There we go. Exactly. I've already gotten a comment that I didn't get Pat's five timers jacket after appearing five times on. So that is on my list. I appreciate the comment that I got on that on LinkedIn. So. Thanks for tuning in to this week's episode of Cross Border Tax Talks. Thank you, Martin Maskan, U.S. tax partner and PwC's foreign tax desk leader. I'm Doug McConey, PwC's international tax services leader. Stay tuned in 2 weeks for another exciting edition of the Cross Border Tax Talks podcast.
This podcast is brought to you by PwC, all rights reserved. PwC refers to the U.S. member firm or one of its subsidiaries or affiliates and may sometimes refer to the PwC network. Each member firm is a separate legal entity. Please see www.pwc.com/structure for further details. This podcast is for general information purposes only and should not be used as a substitute for consultation with professional advisors.